Once a marketer told me that there is never a dull week in the world of advertising. And boy, was he right. There is indeed not a dull week in this advertising world. As a mouthpiece of this industry, ET Brand Equity, we decided to bring to you a weekly show where we analyze the major happenings and major news in this industry. Welcome to the very first and inaugural episode of BE Roundup. As promised, we have with us Mr. Ashish Bhasin, who incidentally completes 30 years in this advertising industry. So a big round of applause to you, Mr. Bhasin. So let's start. Ideally, start with the Desi developments first. And the biggest thing that happened in this week was that IPL concluded, right? And what an IPL it was, right? You know, this was the first time that, you know, Star was hosting it on its platform. 2 years back that, you know, CSK has come back and they have won it. What, according to you, IPL as a media property was like this year?
I think IPL has been an amazing property in India, not just this year, but for the last 10, 11 years that it's been there. One of the things that IPL has done to cricket is that cricket always, or in fact sport, used to be a male-dominated viewership, right, largely. I think IPL has made cricket much more friendly, much more family, because it's a sort of a mixture between entertainment and cricket in that sense. And that trend somehow has got built upon year after year, year after year, and I think the property has become stronger and stronger. I think this year Star getting it brought in a little bit freshness to it. Two or three landmark things I think that happened was that because Hotstar was also their property and they owned both the digital and the television rights, the telecast was nearly simulcast. There was a 20-second or so difference between the two, but it was almost simultaneously cast. And in today's world, that makes a big difference because very often you're on the road, you're in your office, and viewership habits are moving to digital in a rapid way. So I think that helped. Also, for the first time, we had separate feeds in regional languages, particularly for the South. Now, the importance of that is that if I am a local advertiser, if I'm a regional advertiser, it would be a waste of money for me to try and advertise nationally on IPL. So I'm missing out on a very good platform. But now I could do so only on my regional feed. So I think that made a big difference. From a viewer's point of view, of course, it's a very interesting tournament. The finals in Bombay were superb. Two of the best teams were playing. And Chennai is a big favorite. And I think a lot of that credit goes to Dhoni because he's very well loved in Mumbai for sure. In fact, very well loved all over the country. So I think all in all, it's built up to be a property we should all be proud of as a country.
Right. You know, as you rightly said, you know, Dhoni fans, and you know, a great moment for me when I saw Dhoni after such a long time, you know, holding a trophy. So, you know, obviously it was a treat for Dhoni fans. But, you know, going back, so it was the first time that Star was hosting on its platform, and you were right, you know, the timing of IPL is such that, you know, digital consumption happens any way, which ways, because, you know, people are on the move and, you know, Hotstar is a big player in that. Do you think, statistically speaking, right, you know, has Star done a better job of positioning the IPL as the biggest tournament in the for cricket in the world?
The fact is that IPL is the biggest tournament in the world of cricket. Right. And certainly in India, it's very, very big and it has very wide and universal viewership. Right. I think Sony did a very good job for 10 years and built it up and brought it to a certain level. Everybody who comes in fresh with new technology, with new equipment available, etc., obviously it will add, and a fresh pair of eyes adds that. So there was that little bit of freshness. I think Star did a good job building upon a platform which had been built on all those years. I personally feel that over the remaining 4 years of their contract and for the next maybe 10 years to come, this is something that will probably build to be one of the largest sporting properties anywhere in the world, the way it's going. So yes, I think Star did a good job, but I think a lot of that credit should go to the platform and the tournament itself.
Right. And from the advertiser's point of view, they introduced the Reimagine Awards for the best advertising campaign. So there are two questions to it. First layer is, you know, obviously your thought on which was the best campaign that you have seen during the IPL this year. And, you know, overall, how would this Reimagine Awards guarantee that there are more advertisers and there is more creativity in the flow?
To answer your first question, my favorite campaign clearly was the Airtel campaign. I just love that Airtel girl. And I think there is such a freshness to that campaign. And I think the way that they've been able to take it through different subjects, take it across. So sometimes you have to communicate something like speed. Sometimes you have to communicate the network is widely available, etc. But somehow they've been able to find a very innocent, fresh way of doing it. So I quite love that campaign, and that stands out for me in this IPL quite clearly. That's the first bit. On the awards, I think it's a great idea because everybody who works on it, it's a good thing to reward them, to encourage them to come in and sort of put more efforts onto it, because ultimately it is creativity that drives any advertising. So I think these are all steps in the right direction.
Right. And viewers, please, before you forget, please do jot in your questions. And, you know, if you have questions for Mr. Bhasin, for us, we'll have to take it during the course of the show. So moving on, sir, you know, IPL is one of the biggest extravaganzas, right? Another big extravaganza coming up, you know, it has already started this year, and next year is the biggest, the Lok Sabha elections and the elections that are going on, political campaigns. So how do you see AdX moving up this year and share of political campaigns in that?
Look, one thing that I've noticed over the last now 30 years that I've been in advertising, and finished 30 years in advertising literally today, one thing that I've noticed that whenever there's an impending election, first, many months before that, the level of government advertising starts increasing, right? Whether it is state government or central government, all of a sudden many schemes which they never remembered through the last year or 5 years or whatever start getting remembered. So I think we'll see a lot of that happening into the run-up of the election. Of course, once the election is announced, then because of the election commission's rules, etc., that come into play, then the political advertising starts. Now, that's a very different ballgame. It's a different type of advertising. It's a short period of high burst kind of universal appeal sort of advertising that you see. We will see that in elections on that. I feel a lot more of digital will be seen because the battle is moving more and more to the digital bit. So yes, that does help increase the ad-ex, but I think the Indian advertising industry is now big enough and mature enough and is now about 65,000 crores. So while a couple of thousand crores gets added on, it's not that it will significantly move the needle one way or the other, but the advantage of it that happens is that if a good stable government comes in, which people like, then the markets tend to go up. When the markets go up, advertising is very responsive to sentiment because it's the easiest expense to cut for people who see it as an expense, and wrongly so. So it is a lot more sentiment driven than people give it credit for. So when a stable government comes in, if the market feels good, the markets get buoyant, then there's a general positivity in the sentiment of brand owners, of clients in that sense. And that I think in the long run also helps advertising. And the third thing is that if a good government comes in, if there are good policies, then GDP increases. Mm-hmm. Now, a rule of thumb is that if GDP increases by 1 point, advertising usually increases by 1.5. It's a rule of thumb. It's not. So, for example, if GDP goes up from 6 to 7, then advertising may go up from 9 to 10.5, etc., like that, right? And it's usually 1.5 times we've seen. The converse is also true. If the GDP falls, it also falls by 1.5 times. So I think that's the other benefit, that if a good government comes in, GDP will increase. And if the GDP increases, the economy does well, the businesses start booming, then that also will help advertising.
So it's a cycle, full cycle.
It is a cycle. And I personally feel that India is poised in a very interesting place. It's probably a golden era for us.
Right.
The next 10 to 15 years should be very good for us as a country. In many ways, it will be irrespective of which government comes in, as long as we as a country don't do anything silly, which we are also quite capable of doing, as you know. I think it's a very good time for us. Our businesses are strong and stable. The population, which when I was in school, for example, was considered as our biggest burden, I think is now our biggest asset, because it gives us a huge market, a domestic market that we can do it. So I just feel the human capital that we have in India, the entrepreneurial spirit that we have, the excellent cost base, very competitive, highly skilled people, I think we are at a significant advantage to any other market. And I feel that if all goes well, next 10 to 15 years will be a golden phase for India. So I'm a big India fan and a big India optimist, and I do feel everything is going in that direction.
Right. Interestingly, you mentioned about digital advertising and political advertising on digital, right? And there is a huge controversy around Cambridge Analytica, Facebook's role in that, fake WhatsApp messages. So what's the right way of doing that?
If I had the answer to that, I would have been a multi-billionaire, not a multi-millionaire. But look at the mega trends, first of all, as far as India is concerned. We have roughly about 400, 450 million people who are on the internet, which is probably the second or third largest internet population in the world. Right. Okay, but look at the converse side of it. That means about 600 million plus people are not on the internet. So therefore, for the next 5 to 10 years, there's going to be a huge growth of people coming in. So that means digital advertising is going to become more and more the medium. Now, Jio to a large extent has catalyzed this to move faster because data prices have fallen significantly, bandwidths have increased 10x, and handset prices, smartphone prices have fallen significantly. I think 2021 will be a landmark year. Roughly, television reaches 750 million people in India. And Dentsu Aegis Network studies show that in 2021, somewhere around middle of 2021, digital's reach will roughly become the same. Now, if you look at countries like China, like South Korea, etc., who are a little ahead of us in the digital journey, you will find that once the digital reach reaches almost that of the television reach, that becomes like a tipping point. And then a significant uptick happens. And I think in India, that is what is going to happen, right? So it is a trend. All businesses, we are heading towards 100% digital economy. There is no business that's not going to get impacted by digital, and therefore digital advertising, reaching consumers through digital data, technology, all of that is now a part of our life more and more, and will be clearly the trend. If you look at the advertising industry is growing at about between 8 to 10%, right? While digital advertising is growing around 25%. So it's growing 2.5 times that. So that's a clear trend. But when you have something as new and as revolutionary as digital, and I say new and revolutionary because in India, it's a last 5 to 10 year phenomenon, essentially. Something like that happens, then there is a new set of opportunities and a new set of problems also that come with it.
Right.
Fake news is one of them. On that. I think data privacy is going to be another one of them. We are a country which is generating, as consumers, we're generating a digital footprint in everything we do, whether you go to a movie or you buy anything online or you use your credit card or you use your mobile, we're leaving a digital footprint, huge amounts of data through the Aadhaar, all our biometrics are now available. So now this data can be used very, very effectively, but then there is a danger of misuse as well. So I think we will evolve rules, regulations, checks and balances. Finally, you will have to use technology to counter technology. So you spoke about Cambridge Analytica. I think it is the responsibility of large tech giants, the duopoly of Google and Facebook, as it's called, to use their tremendous technological expertise as well as tremendous resources to find solutions to problems like these. Because I do believe that the solutions will be technology-based solutions. It's impossible today to have solutions that are not tech-based. But the good thing is that human beings are very resilient, and they, whenever a problem comes up, they find a way around it. And I'm sure that's what will happen on this.
Right. I think we can have a separate debate only on the issue of data privacy and in advertising. But we moving on. Just got a question from one of the viewers. Asking us about, as you mentioned, Jio, right? And this week we saw Patanjali launch a, cellular connection, and they entered the telecommunications business. What's your predictions about that?
Look, Patanjali is one of the most amazing brands. I had the privilege to interview last year Acharya Balakrishnan at the Goa Fest.
Yes.
And this year, Baba Ramdev himself. So very interesting. Also a good test of my rusty Hindi. so very interesting. This thing. I think the most amazing thing I find about that brand is that every and anything that you've learned in advertising and marketing, he turns it on its head but makes it a success. So you're taught that you should never stretch a brand beyond its limits, right? So, but he's launched a Patanjali shampoo and a Patanjali honey, a food product and a soap and a toothpaste and whatever, right? He's not used celebrities, he's used himself, very
himself is the
direct advertising, but he has caught the human insight of Ayurveda, natural product. It's a natural, a trend, a consumer trend. He has caught the nub of it at the right time. And of course, the products must be, would be good, and which is why they, and at an affordable price point, which is why they sold that well. So they've been tremendous so far in whatever they've done. They've defied every logic and any logic. Companies have taken 100 years to build 10,000 crores of turnover in this part of the business. He's done it in maybe 2, 3, 4 years in a very relatively short time. As a competitor of his, if I were a competitor of his, I would be worried if he launches in any area. And the positioning of the brand in my mind is that it will give you a reasonably good product in a value for money manner. Right. So it's quite likely that whatever business he gets in, he studies it, it will be at a low, affordable price,
right,
and will appeal to a lot of people. He is also pegging it in a very interesting way, which is that it's almost like a larger cause. It's for the cause of nationalism in a sense, because it's about be Indian, buy Indian, anti-multinational, etc. So it's a very interesting positioning.
We are getting a lot of questions, but viewers, we can't take all of them, but we'll kind of get back to you on the comments below. But I'll take one more. You know, very interesting. You know, since we are on the desi questions and national happenings, one of the most significant move just announced today was probably Martin Sorrell, Sir Martin Sorrell getting into a finance company and then turning it around to be an advertising giant. So the question here is the impact in India. That's why I'm saying, it's a desi development, because, Martin Sorrell is as much as India as he's outside, right? So your take on that?
Look, I think I'm a competitor of his, but I think he's an amazing guy, right? Of all the global heads of advertising agencies, I think he knew India much better than all of them put together.
Right.
And he probably visited India more often in 1 year than most of them do in their entire tenure.
Exactly.
This was when he was in WPP, one of his 150 countries. But he knew, he knew journalists by first name. He knew clients, not just the senior guys, but second level. He knew his team, of course, the senior guys, the mid-level guys. He knew his competitors like me. I've had several email exchanges with him, met with him. So he was amazing.
And that's why, that's why I said, Martin Sorrell, Sir Martin Sorrell is as much India as him, as
he is. And other than me, he's the only guy I found who replies to his emails that fast, which everybody is talking about. He's almost as quick as I am. So I think he's an amazing guy. He understands India well. He's an India bull. Therefore, I'm pretty sure whatever business he does, two things. One is that he will be successful. He understands his business. And it will have an India angle in some way or the other.
Right.
Of course, when a guy as leader, as senior as him, who's had a 33-year run, has built up the business, leaves, of course, there will be an impact on his businesses. WPP is a large company with lots of managers, and I'm sure they'll be robust enough to manage it through. But it would be naive to feel for, and I'm sure they themselves would confess, that it would be naive to feel that something like this will not have an impact. So we will see some impact, but hopefully their organization will have depth to see it through.
Right. I know that we are running out of time, but I still think we have some time to catch like a couple of questions. We are. I'm just passing through some of the international happenings. But one of the major things, and something that I relate to and I want to ask, you have been representing India, as a part of Dentsu, we have been representing the country across the world, right? So how do you see the image of brand India, right, getting across to the world, and how do people perceive? I'm not saying it from a political point of view when, people say that, India's image has changed. I'm saying from the business point of view, right? You have been, as you said, right, across 30 years, right, across 3 decades, you have seen the business grow. So how is it India as an advertising market perceived?
Look, I had the good fortune and opportunity to run businesses as a part of my remit in several countries, largely in APAC.
Right.
And in the course of that, had to extensively travel. I probably traveled to more than 70, 75 countries on business. I've run businesses in maybe more than 15, 20 countries. So the image and importance of the Indian advertising professional in some ways gets linked to you as an Indian who's in that field when you go out. If I see the journey over the last 30 years, my first exposure was when I tried for Unilever to do commercials and advertising in markets like Burma, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, where Lever goods were being distributed, but they didn't have, neither was the agencies there, nor did they have offices there. So through Unilever International, when I was in Lintas, I actually created like a mobile agency using Prahlad Kakkad as a producer, Chinwin Lee as a photographer, and we actually went and shot on locations over there because you had to produce it there. Now, one thing that everybody always recognized was that there was an element of creativity in Indians, but we were looked upon very differently then when you went out as businessmen. We never had money, you had very limited dollars, you would, there were exchange control rules, etc., etc. So we weren't considered serious businessmen, but we were considered people who had good sense of advertising, but bichare third world countries se hain was the, unsaid feeling on that. That has dramatically and diametrically changed. And now, one thing I'll tell you as a fact. So when I was running Southeast Asia, for example, if I were hiring an MD for one of my companies in, let's say, Singapore, and if there were two candidates or Thailand or Malaysia or Indonesia or Philippines or any one of the countries I was handling, if there were two managing directors and if one were an Indian and one was a local person, I would have preferred to choose the local person because that's the right thing to do. And also you don't want to be seen as because you're Indian, you're favoring an Indian guy. But the fact of the matter is that 7 out of 10 times I ended up choosing an Indian candidate if they were two, simply because they were far better. We work harder. We're used to working in so many constraints out here that when you get into a market where there are no constraints, we flower on that. Very sharp, very intelligent, highly educated people. So I think there is a lot of respect for Indian talent. Indian managers are running some of the biggest advertising businesses globally. And one trend you're going to see, which is also going to become a problem for us, is that the Indian talent is now so valued, particularly with this technology, because we have an edge in technology, in IT and digital and all of these areas. Indian talent is getting so valued that we will have quite a pull on our good talent in that sense. So you now feel proud to be an Indian, and you're already seen with a lot of respect, and we are now seen as a very serious market. We're also one of the few high growth markets of size in the world. I mean, it's very funny, you meet some of your colleagues from Tokyo or from Europe, etc., and they say, oh, we've had a great year, the economy has grown by 1%. In India, if the economy grows by 6%, we go into depression. We almost assume that, 7 and 7.5% is our birthright and is our norm. So I think there is a lot of positivity, and I think this will increase and improve more and more. The one area which Indians, as in the advertising field, do need to, I think, improve more upon is that we need to package ourselves better, and we lack finesse. Our work lacks finesse sometimes. We have good ideas. We don't know how to present them well enough. And when I judge, for example, at Cannes or at any of the global awards, I sometimes wish that, we presented our ideas and work a lot better, because there are some countries who have mastered this. Their ideas are not as strong, their work is not as strong, but they present it 10 times better than us. So I think in the advertising area in general, that's the area of development, if I were to say.
Right. And finally, sir, I know I'm holding you long. What's new from the Dentsu Aegis Network?
Look, I have to tell you the history for this. So we were 90 years late in this market. Our competitors were here. I think WPP was here in the 1920s. I think Lintas was set up, IPG through Lintas was here in 1938, right? I brought Aegis in 2008. So we were, if you so to speak, 90 years late or something in the market. Now when you're
and I think that's why you were digital heavy, sir. I mean,
That's exactly it. So some of our competitors were saying, but digital is only 4% of the market. And they were right. It was only 4% then. It made a lot of sense for them to rely upon traditional media, print, TV, because they were making a lot of money in that. It didn't take much effort. But therein is where we spotted an opportunity. We went very heavy on digital. So today, for example, about 15-17% of the Indian advertising market is digital. But in Dentsu Aegis Network, we get something like 42% of our revenues from digital. Out of our 3,600 people, 1,650 are digital. Out of our 25 agencies, 8 agencies are just pure digital agencies, right? And that worked very well for us because, like I said before, digital is growing 3 times faster than the market. So now the next step in this is that data, which I spoke about, we want to build databases which are completely privacy secure and compliant to all the new laws, etc., which by 2020, I want to be able to target 200 to 250 million Indians. Because if you do that, then you have a very large, reliable database, and you don't have to sort of guess who your advertising is reaching and what should be the content of it. Because data is truly going to be the new oil in advertising, and people who are missing it are missing a trick. So you will see a lot of effort from us in those areas. Having said that, India is also a very unique market where yin and yang both exist together. So while digital is going to be on a huge upswing, but we have large markets in outdoor. We have 30, 40, 50 airports coming up in small cities where transit advertising is going to become big. Cinema, I mean, we are the world's largest cinema country, and the most underexploited advertising medium perhaps is cinema, right? So I want to concentrate on those areas. What we will not do is take the lazy route of just doing a 30-second ad or a 100cc ad and doing whatever has been done before. We like to break it up and rebuild it, break it up and rebuild it. And we want to future-proof our business. By 2020, we believe we want to be ready for a 100% digital economy. Because, like I said before, no business is going to be not impacted by digital. So you will see Dentsu Aegis Network doing a lot of that. And you will see aggressive growth. We're very ambitious, very agile people. And we're very clear that we are going to be, we are the fastest growing group in India and now the second largest group by far in India. But we're very clear that the future of advertising and marketing communications in India will be defined by Dentsu Aegis Network.
Great. On that note, you know, I will wait for the next biggest update from your end, we'll definitely meet again and have time to discuss this again. Thank you so much, sir. With this, we come to an end of today's episode. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to ET Brand Equity.